com. Views, opinions, claims, or representations are those of the participants and are not those of 1490 WERE AM's owners or management. Broadcast or rebroadcast in any form of 1490 WERE programming is prohibited unless otherwise agreed to in writing.
This is for them rough days when you feel like giving up days. That's right. Here's a little something, put a smile on your face.
Good afternoon and good evening, and welcome to another edition of OCU Forum, your forum. I'm Darnell Brewer, and this is
Miss Mariah.
And today is Friday, April 19th, 2013. We survived another week here in the Terror Dome that we call
Cleveland. Here you go again with that word.
Yeah, we know. We know so many things that goes on here.
Oh, come on, I forget now. We are simulcasting live.
And yes, we are simulcasting live from Planet Do Right.
That's right, because we got to do what's right.
And we got to do what's right. And as usual, we always tell you to grab a pen and a piece of paper, because we're going to have some very valuable information to pass along for the next 2 hours here on OCU Forum. And, you know, I always start off by asking my co-host, how was her week?
I had a great week, Darnell. You know I'm still celebrating my birthday.
Well, I have. I've met people who celebrate their birthday all month.
Well, see, my goddaughter, she said, Mama, look now, you deserve it. You need to celebrate the whole month. Just do whatever you want to do.
Well, not whatever.
Oh, I've been doing whatever I want to do.
and as the story goes, we shall continue on.
Yes, we shall.
We do have a guest in our studio today, and I'm gonna
try to behave myself.
And we're gonna cover some important topics again in our second hour. But we do have a guest in the studio with us, Mr. Attorney Anthony Jordan. Am I correct?
That's correct.
We may know him from a lot of the cases here in Cleveland. You may have seen his face or heard his voice in and around the city of Cleveland. And now you're taking on another challenge here in the city.
That's right.
The challenge you're working on, as people don't know already.
but before we get into that, we have to tell our sponsors thank you.
Let's tell our sponsors thank you.
We have to say thank you to Magi Ultimate Fitness Studio for sponsoring us. And Magi, we appreciate your undergirding our efforts and supporting everything we've been doing in the community. We also want to say thank you to Kincaid's Kindred Spirits. You can reach them on Facebook. Kincaid's Kindred Spirits is a support group and system for persons who are afflicted with, come on, Danielle, pop quiz.
Sickle cell.
Thank you. And so you can reach them on Facebook, and they are also a nonprofit.
And we are going to have them on our show to talk about sickle cell, because that is a very dangerous and misinformed disease.
And I think we're also going to try to get some folks on from University Hospital to talk about lupus, because that's a very misinformed.
That's another one, too. Right. Yes. And, you know, we're all about education, and we got to do what's right. So, yes, we're definitely going to have them come across our airwaves. And during the course of our conversation, if you want to join in our conversation, 578-1490, just in case we forget to give out the numbers, 578-1490. But as we were talking, we were introducing our guest, Attorney Anthony Jordan, who is taking on another challenge here in the city of Cleveland. But before you tell them about the challenge that you're taking on and one that you may be undertaking as we speak, give the people a little history about yourself.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for having me. And I didn't know it was your birthday, Miss Mariah.
Thank you.
Happy belated.
Thank you.
And for Darnell, thank you for having me as well.
No problem. Thank you for coming.
For your listeners who don't know, I should tell you that Miss Mariah does not have a face for radio.
I'm ugly, y'all.
She should be on TV. You should see her tonight. Anyway,
I'm all girly tonight because I didn't have to work today, so my sweats were like thrown in the corner, and I said this is my girl weekend. So yay! Oh,
all right. Well, thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming.
I'm glad to be here. I'm running for judge, as you know. I have had a career here in Cleveland as an attorney. It's been very rewarding for me. I've had the opportunity to represent people from Cleveland and around Cleveland. I've had a great time in my practice. As you know, I was a former chief prosecutor for the city of mm-hmm. Cleveland. That was a very rewarding time as well. And it was also very challenging. Prior to that, I worked in City Hall. I did civil work for the city of Cleveland. And prior to that, I was in private practice.
What did you do in private practice?
I did everything.
Everything?
I did it all. You know, I was young. I was trying to sustain myself, so I took all kinds of cases. I took cases from criminal cases, bankruptcy cases, personal injury cases, just whatever kept the lights on and kept the family fed.
How long have you been practicing all together?
16 years.
Ooh, 16.
Yeah, I'm older than I look.
No, I don't believe it.
I'm 48, Miss Mariah.
Really?
Yes.
I'm a year behind you.
See, I knew you
were still babies.
I knew you were a young girl.
We still babies.
I knew you were young.
Yes, I'm young. Young at heart.
Look, I forgot.
Why
I was
you
here.
Playing?
No, I forgot I was here.
I know
you're
going to forget again. Keep playing, Donnell.
Brother Donnell.
Brother Donnell.
Well, it's fun here. I'm planning to do right.
Yeah, oh, my
right,
God, yes.
We have
yes.
fun.
Yes, we have fun. We definitely have fun. And this has been a good week. And we've had a lot of things that we've been doing in the city. And in fact, that's how I met you.
Right.
We were at the housing clinic that Housing Court, Judge Pianta.
Concerned citizens.
Right.
Over.
And they have another one coming up. I don't know if you know about it, but May 9th.
Yes.
And we'll be talking about that as we get more information mm-hmm. concerning it. But Ohio Communities United is dedicated to bringing our community back to life. I think there's still a glimmer of hope there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to keep, like, giving it CPR mm-hmm. and pumping it and trying to get people to come together because I believe we can do it. And I think I said this to Darnell a couple weeks ago. I said our generation is a generation that has to pick up and run right now because those like my dad, Stan Tolliver, have gone on. And the ones who are still here are older. They're out of energy. They're out of juice. And it's up to us now. Mm-hmm. We have to pick it up. And so when when they told me that you were going to be running for judge, what kind of judge are you going to run for?
I'm running for Cleveland Municipal Court.
Oh, Cleveland Municipal
and,
Court.
And for yes. those who don't know, could you kind of explain the difference between municipal and county? Because that's where a lot of our people get mixed up. When they think of judges, they think it's just one flat judicial system.
Right. Right. Well, the municipal court has a bit of what we call overlapping jurisdiction with the county court. But primarily from a criminal point of view, we handle traffic cases. You know, when you get the tickets, you come down, that's anything from stop sign violations to speeding to OVIs or DUIs, driving under suspension, operating a motor vehicle without a license. And small claims, you know, when you have a major case involving a large sum of money or, you know, mm-hmm. corporations, then mm-hmm. you go to Common Pleas Court.
Correct.
So Common Pleas Court handles felonies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're talking about your murders, your rapes, higher level drug cases and things like that. But I like the municipal court. I do practice in all courts right now. I practice mm-hmm. in federal court. Practicing Common Pleas Court, appellate courts, and of course Cleveland Municipal Court, as well as all the other municipalities, Shaker Heights, Cleveland Heights. So
I love law. I do. Sometimes.
Well, you got it honest.
Well, I know.
Yeah,
I know.
I worked with your father.
I went to law school, and you know, but it's it just ain't for me.
I worked with your father when I first became a lawyer. Well, I knew him before that. I've known him my whole life because I was in the NAACP youth council when I was. When I was a kid, and of course, my father was an attorney, and he practiced with your father. So you got it honest, Miss Mariah.
I know. I know. It's in me. It's in me. It's I can't get away from it. Darnell will tell you I bring everything back to the law. We talk about stuff, and I'm like, okay, let me tell you what the law says about this. But I do. I love the law. I love the thought of practicing. But I think where I'm at
is
where I belong.
This is a nice place.
This is where I belong. But I did argue my first case in front of the Court of Appeals back in, what was it, September, I think it was? Yeah.
Okay.
And that was, like, just so cool because that's when I really felt my dad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I really felt that he was part of me because I really litigated that one. Mm-hmm. That was a real good oral argument. And, you know, when the other attorney looks at you and growls, and doesn't want to shake your hand.
Unfortunately, that happens. That does happen.
So, you know, but, you know, I find that my work is on the outside, and so I would much rather do what I'm doing and be where I am and be a much happier person. And so that's why we wanted you here tonight, because we wanted to talk to you about some of these things that, you know, people are wondering about in terms of, you know, how can you be the changing point for, you know, being in the municipal court? What can you bring that's going to be different that people will say, you know what? Yeah, he should be a municipal court judge.
Well, I think one of the things is that I have a very vast experience. As I said, I told you that I did start off in a general practice, and then I went and I was what they call chief of torts for 5 years for the city of Cleveland, which is injury. It gave me a perspective from a civil point of view. Then after that, when I became a chief prosecutor, I think that's very pertinent to what I think I bring. I think that's very important to what I bring to the table in this particular endeavor. Being on the bench and having experience of being an exclusive person reviewing the internal affairs cases, you know, that was part of what I did as the chief prosecutor. Investigations were conducted, they were concluded, and they were presented to me as a chief prosecutor. So I think that in and of itself gives me a unique perspective, because, you know, I've been out to these community meetings and I hear so many people with so many concerns, community concerns about police officers and, you know, anything from allegations of criminality to just being rude, just, you know, that takes away from people's confidence, you know. And I think that, you know, when you're on the bench, when you're a judge, you should have some experience with understanding, you know, the police and the possible interactions police might have with citizens, and not just from being in the courtroom or, you know, not just from watching television, but also to, you know, having known that there are investigations of police, that sometimes they are disciplined. When you're in court, oftentimes you don't know what the discipline history of a police officer is. You know, not that I would know that in any given case, but I do know that that does happen because, as I said, I was the person who reviewed all those cases. So that's one major piece. Also, I think that, and this isn't all that unique, but, you know, I think in tandem with all my other experiences, representing people, representing the citizens, the people from this community, I know what the impact is. I haven't been on the bench. Some people, that's all they've ever done. They've never even represented a client, a real client before. I know what it's like to, you know, have a family impacted by adverse decision, you know, in the courtroom. I know what it's like to have to go in the hallway, you know, outside the view of the court and have to talk to families. I know what it's like to go to their homes, to speak to them in their living rooms, and talk about, you know, the real life impacts of what goes on in court.
We have a caller. Excuse me. Hi, Joshua? Jose?
Yes. Hello.
Hi,
hey, Jose.
Jose.
You're on the air. How are you?
I'm wonderful. How are y'all?
Good.
I'm sorry I butchered your name, but Leo typed it in wrong.
Yeah, he did. okay. Yeah, I have a question for the lawyer there. I'm a truck driver. And 2 years ago, I got pulled over coming from a football game with OVI. Officer pulled me over, OVI. And I went to court, and we filed motion to suppress evidence. But the judge wouldn't review the evidence because my lawyer didn't give, it wasn't 35 days. We didn't do it in time. So the point, what I'm trying to see is that we had when I went to court, they asked me if I could drive with my license, if I was able to get they lowered to a reckless driving. But I found out I can't drive with a reckless driving.
Reckless operation.
For 10 years. I'm being a truck driver.
Right, you have a CDL, commercial driver's license, right?
Correct.
Right, okay.
Now, I was wondering if you can get that lowered, if I was to write the judge and see if I can get it reduced to maybe failure control.
Jose, you know, I'm getting a feeling that they don't want this to turn into a legal advice show. But
no,
I tell you,
no, it's not that.
Case to case. I was just hoping Jose wasn't one of your old clients.
No, that wasn't me. That wasn't me. And I was gonna say, Jose, don't say whoever the lawyer was.
Yeah, I didn't.
But
I think I would have got a better deal.
I like to think so. But Jose, let me tell you this. There are situations. I'm not absolutely certain. I would have to do some research and look into it. But there is available in some circumstances where you can go back and withdraw a formally entered plea. You know, you can file a motion. And I'm not sure if that can be done in this case, but I'd have to check into it.
If Jose wants to get in contact with you, have a phone number he can give you a call?
Yeah, you anyone who is interested in speaking with me for consultation can call my office at
216-523-1100.
And we'll repeat it a couple more times, so just keep listening to our show, Jose. Mm-hmm. And we thank you for calling.
Every Friday.
Do you?
Thank you.
Jose.
Uh-oh.
Jose, have you ever seen Miss Mariah?
No, I haven't seen her.
All right.
I haven't gotten a chance to meet the sister.
All right. All right. Well, if you've been listening, then you, she looks about the way she sounds, if you've been listening closely.
Hey, That's beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. She is.
All right,
she is.
Thank y'all.
Thanks
thank
for calling.
You. Thank
Jose.
You for listening too. Thank you
Bye-bye.
For listening too.
And we appreciate our callers. We really do. And there are a lot of people who have been listening to us for weeks and have not called in. And we want you to call in. I know that sometimes Darnell and I get carried away and we get into it, and sometimes we hit all bases, but we still want to hear from you, because that's what OCU Forum is about. It's about you calling in and voicing what you think, voicing what's going on in the community and approaches. We're more strategic than anything else. We want to come up with ideas and methods to bring the community together and address those issues.
Yeah, 216-578-1490, just in case someone else wants to give us a call in to the show. Yeah, we definitely love our listeners. Let me ask you another question when it comes to the Cleveland Municipal Court. The candidate that you're running against,
yes.
Unfortunately, not my preferred candidate. I wish we had a ran against.
You're not supposed to say
there.
That, Darnell. You're supposed to be neutral.
I'm not
going to
say her name. A black female. She's been there for a while. Her father used to be. But anyway, what makes you more qualified, you know, than the candidate that you're running against? You know, say for instance, someone when they go to the ballot, they see your name, the other candidate. When they look at your name, what do you want them to take with them to the ballot so they can hit your name versus the person, you know, that you're running against?
Okay.
And you know what? Why you ask him that? And we at 7:23. So you
no,
did
he
this.
Can. He can. He actually can hold that. He can simmer
okay.
that thought.
All right, because you did this to
when
me last
come
week.
Back,
you know, you did this to me last week, right?
No,
and I got in trouble.
No, you went over. The
break. I went over. You was playing a game.
No. I was. Doing
okay.
research.
Brother Jordan, you're going to get used to us. Trust me. Now, our audience is used to us.
You, Miss Mariah is asking questions and she's cleaning at the
I
same
am.
Time.
I OCD. Am. I OCD. Am cleaning. I am. Quit playing with me. We will be back in just a moment. Stay with OCU Forum with Darnell Brewer and
Miss Mariah, your forum. OCU.
Not only are we streaming live at newstalkcleveland.com, but you can stay connected to what we're up to by joining our Facebook fan page and following us on Twitter. Just type in Newstalk 1490 and become a part of our family.
Saving energy saves you money. Whether you switch to Energy Star light bulbs, install Energy Star appliances, or add extra insulation. Learn more at energysavers.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Energy and the Ad Council.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This could cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us if you want Viagra at the lowest prices. Never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-570-0910 today to save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 800-570-0910 to take your call now. Call 800-570-0910. That's 800-570-0910. Again, 800-570-0910.
I am a mother.
I am an entrepreneur.
I am a singer.
I am an artist.
I'm a journalist.
A businesswoman.
An educator.
A sister.
A grandmother.
An advocate.
A leader.
I am a friend.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am one of more than a million people living with HIV in the U.S.
We are not alone.
Let's stop HIV together.
Get the facts. Get tested. Get involved. Go to www.actagainstaids.org for more information.
What a day for a family reunion. Denise, give Grandpa a hug. Mm-mm. Hit a home run for me today?
You bet.
My family means a lot to me since I found out I have diabetes. It can cause major health problems, so I'm taking control. I exercise, watch what I eat, take my medicine, and test my blood sugar. I keep my diabetes under control so I can see my granddaughter, the next Jackie Robinson.
Control your diabetes for life. Call 1-800-438-5383. This message sponsored by the Ohio Department of Health, aired by the Ohio Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Have you asked yourself, can I really lose this weight? Do you stay away from large public workout facilities? Are you unsure of where you should start? Do you suffer from fibromyalgia, arthritis, hypertension, back pain? Let Majai Ultimate Fitness help you. Conveniently located in University Circle, Majai understands the physical and mental struggles of weight loss and physical limitations. Our one-on-one personal training plans are affordable and designed just for you. No general workout plan here. No one-size-fits-all, no boot camp. Majai is a completely holistic and homeopathic approach to gaining control of your life. We're located at 10916 Magnolia Drive in Cleveland, Ohio. Call us at 216-240-5669. We welcome men, women, and children. We are the Royal Bodyguards of Fitness because your royalty starts here. Majai Ultimate Fitness Studio, 216-240-5669. Call for your appointment today.
Don't yell at your radio. Call us up and let us know what's on your mind. The News Talk 1490 phone lines are open now. Call 216-578-1490. That's 216-578-1490 now. To get in touch with News Talk 1490 WERE, the People Station.
This is for them rough days, when you feel like giving up days.
Welcome back. Welcome back to OCU Farm. This is Darnell Brewer, and this is
Miss Mariah.
And for the last couple of minutes, we've been talking to and talking with Attorney Anthony Jordan, who is a candidate for Cleveland Municipal Court. And he, right before we cut to the break, I asked a question in reference to him and his challenger. When you enter into the booth and you see those two names, what do you want people to take away so they can hit your name versus your opponent's name?
Okay. Thank you. So to begin with, I am a registered Democrat. So the people know. And she is a Republican.
You know, and let me just say this, because I know your opponent is very well. A lot of people didn't know that in their last race.
They don't know.
They don't. I didn't know until I had a conversation with her, and someone pointed it out to me.
And, you know, to her credit, she's a very, you know, affable, very charming person. And as I said a couple of days ago at an event in Mount Pleasant, I'm not running against her because, you know, I think she's a bad person. But I think that I'm clearly a better candidate than her, and I have numerous reasons why. I mentioned that I'm a Democrat because that's reflective of the community. It's more so reflective than a Republican sitting on the bench in Cleveland, Ohio. But besides that, you know, my experience with people, I practice in front of her. I practice in front of every single other municipal court judge in the city of Cleveland. She hasn't done that. I have. She's, to my knowledge, has never represented a family or a client outside of she worked for Bill Mason. I don't know if she's ever really had to deal with sitting down with people from the community and trying to understand what their concerns are and what their problems are, and I have.
Now, I think she also has a mental health docket, if I'm not mistaken. Will you continue that on once you become the – will you continue having special attention to the docket when it comes to, you know?
That's something that is not – it wouldn't go away.
Okay.
If I win, when I win, that's something that's part of the superintendence of the court itself. That's something that Judge Ron Adrian, who was the administrative judge.
Oh, that is my buddy. I love Ron. I love Ron to death. That is my buddy.
He is the administrative judge. So he is in charge of assigning, and I'm sure that, you know, there was some input with the other judges as who was best suited to do that. So that docket would not go away.
Good. And yeah, and I admire Ron Adrian also because I was in his courtroom one day with a friend of mine's, and he was sick as all get out, but he still carried that docket. He was coughing, he was wheezing, he was asking for tea, and he still carried that docket, and that's a sign of a good judge. Will you still have that commitment too once you – come on the bench? Well, you know, I'm not saying come sick.
I'm not coming in there with no cooties, okay? You need to quit playing.
Ms. Mariah,
and me and Mariah just had to talk about that.
Yeah,
she just sanitized this whole table.
This whole just sanitized us.
I sure did. That's why y'all sanitized. Got sick last time.
Like you know, I like to think that I would take the same approach to the bench and moving the docket. You know, that's one of the concerns that people have. You know, as an attorney, that's a concern that I hear. I used to be the president of the Black Bar Association, so I also know the concerns of the lawyers as well. And one of the concerns sometimes is how quickly or how efficiently the docket moves, and sometimes it doesn't move. And when that happens, lawyers are stuck in one place.
I know. Well, when one of the judges there,
what are y'all doing?
Two does have a problem with moving the docket very well. And I'm hoping that you don't, when you get down, become stagnant like that specific judge that sits down there as
Stop
we speak.
Stop it, Darnell. I like that judge.
Kind
of, sort of, but I like that judge.
Well, anyway, go ahead, Mariah.
What?
We have too much fun behind these mics. We just have too much. Give the people a sense of what you do outside of your legal experience. What type of committees do you sit on? I know you have mentioned NAACP. Give the people some civic community things that you do out in the community so they can see you outside of the realm of, you know, just attorney. Right.
One of my major passions is the AXO competition, the Academic Cultural Technological
Assignment.
Jocelyn, that's my big sister. From way back when I was a youth council member.
Okay.
But yeah, that's one of my major passions. You know, we're getting ready for that this year.
Yes.
I missed the meeting on Wednesday.
It was
yesterday. So that's one of my major ones. And, you know, working with kids in any capacity, that's one of my philosophies in life, is that, you know, life is primarily for children, and you have to do, you know, put your money where your mouth is when it comes to that, meaning your time. And I've worked with Beulah Baptist Hunger Ministry on Thursdays where we pass out food. I haven't been there recently, but that's something that I've done. I do have a concern about hunger in the community. I've done adult literacy. That's something that I've actually sort of tugged on my heart in court, long time ago. You know, people, they ask you, can you read or write? And you take it for granted. Most people usually say yes. And one time a person in full court. It wasn't like it was the end of the docket. It was a full docket. The courtroom was full of people, and it was just seemed humiliating when he had to say in open court that he could not. And that, you know, that tugged at me. So I went to read, and I signed up and was trained as an adult literacy tutor.
Oh, dude. Right. Very good. Very good. Well, we hope people, you know, do consider, you know, you as a candidate for judge, because you seem like very qualified. Now, let me ask you a question. I'm in the courtroom. I've did 10 miles over the speed limit.
About to role play. Okay.
And I come in your courtroom and I say, judge, I'm not guilty. And mind you that the other.
Wait a minute. This is after you just said I was 10 miles over
Yeah, I did 10 miles over the speed limit.
Okay.
And I'm saying to myself, and I'm saying to you, judge, I'm not guilty. And the police officer didn't show up. What do we do?
Well, I don't think we would have that discussion if the police officer hadn't been there.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, I know we're going to have that discussion, but I should say this, but the police wrote me a ticket for going 10 miles over the speed limit.
Wrote you a ticket for that.
Yeah, okay. You were going 10 miles.
And the officer didn't show up.
Okay. Well, then, in that situation, the city of Cleveland does not have a witness to present if it's the day of trial, which typically a situation like that would be the day of trial.
Right.
And I would tell you, I would ask you, do you want to make a motion? Hint, hint. And you would say yes, motion to dismiss. And I would say dismiss for want of prosecution. Have a good day, sir. Try to abide by the laws of the city of Cleveland.
Okay. I thought you was going to ask for a continuance to make sure the officer get there.
Okay. That's not the court's. That's not the court's job to ask for continuances. Typically, good. Anyway.
Good. Okay. You have anything?
Why are you throwing it at me?
I've asked several questions.
I'm trying to behave myself.
No, you don't have to behave.
I was being bad the first 25 minutes of the show. I'm trying to behave myself, and you just over here pushing stuff and asking, do I want to ask something? And
no, we have a person who's going to be judge. And
I know.
And one thing that I noticed when we go to the Justice Center, it usually be just us in the Justice Center.
That's another.
Okay, so I do have a question.
Yes.
Here's my question.
Yes.
Why did you decide to become or run for Muni instead of Court of Common Pleas?
Well, and then, to be honest with you, it's mainly because I've had so much contact with the municipal court. As again, you know, when I was the chief prosecutor, for the city of Cleveland, and I wasn't what Bill McGinty now is. He's elected prosecutor for Cuyahoga County. And at that time, Bill Mason was the prosecutor for Cuyahoga County. So my experience is more intimate with the Cleveland Municipal Court. Besides that, you know, philosophically, I have a concern for the city, you know, the city itself. The city's going through a lot of changes. You touch so many people in municipal court every day. The docket is, Judge Patton was saying that the event at Mount Pleasant yesterday. And even Judge Cassidy had mentioned that, sometimes you're dealing with 140 cases on the docket. So you touch so many people, and I don't always think that judges are always mindful of the impact that they're having on that person's day or that person's week or that person's life. And I want to just use my experience to try to impact people either less negatively or more positively. And it's a quality of life court. Cleveland Municipal Court is a quality of life court. You can see what's going on in the community as the trends come in. These are primarily not felonies. We do, first appearances on felonies and set bonds on felonies. But these misdemeanors impact quality of life in the city. And it also affects quality of life for the people who are in the jurisdiction of the Cleveland Municipal Court. And I have a concern for the city.
Are you a fan of creative sentencing? And the reason I ask that, because we've seen, some of the one judge do some creative sentencing for certain cases. Are you a fan of creative? Or let me ask you a question.
Like Judge Chickenetti. Let's talk about Judge Chickenetti.
Judge
we're going to go outside of Cleveland, okay?
Go outside of Cleveland.
Judge Chickenetti. I know you know who he is.
Yes.
Where he's come up with some creative sentencing and followed through with a lot of those things. Do you believe in that kind of
Let's see. Well, recourse? my very, very good friend and former boss, Judge Pinky Carr, who
we love Pinky here.
Who is
That's my girl.
We love Pinky.
Who is the judicial goddess? she uses creative sentencing. Now I don't know if anyone else in the court does it to that extent, or if they do at all. And I think it's a new thing. You know, I haven't seen it in our court, in Cleveland Municipal Court. She does it. I'm going to sit back for a while and see how effective that is.
Well, the last judge I knew who did creative sentences was Judge Leotis Harris.
Okay.
But that was with Juvenile. I remember I've seen it where he had Young Men roll the dice to see, you know, to do some things of that nature. He did a lot of creative sentences when it came to juveniles. That was the last time I personally had seen it. I'm not sure, like you said, inside the municipal court.
Yeah, you know, it's there's a lot of room in, you know, the legislature creates the penalties,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm,
for any given crime. And, you know, there is creativity. And I do think that you do have to look at things on a case-by-case basis. And I think that is part of, you know, why good judges can be good judges, because they do look at situations on a case-by-case basis, and they can be creative and think of things. I don't know to what extent, mm-hmm, but, you know, I'm a solution-oriented person. You know, I listen to a lot of jazz, so I like to improvise.
Okay.
I like the thought, the notion behind improvisation.
Now, well, you brought up a very interesting point, and since you have an attorney, when it comes to laws, a lot of people don't understand how does a law become a law? Because, you just said the state, hands down, and when they come into the courtroom, all they see is you as a judge. They say, why is he doing this, or why did he give you that? Could you kind of explain that just briefly?
Well, you know, it's just like, you know, anything. It's like watching a football game. There are parameters, there are rules, there are referees, and, you know, the referees on the field do not make up the laws.
Mm-hmm.
They don't make up the rules in the game. You know, they don't there's been a lot of controversy. I don't know if you got a lot of NCAA basketball fans, but there was a lot of discussion about the kind of fouls that the NCAA, mm-hmm, I say NCAA rules on fouls were controversial,
right,
but the referees, you know, don't make them up in the middle of the game. And that's basically, you know, you have the legislatures, the various legislatures, the city of Cleveland,
mm-hmm,
creates,
mm-hmm,
the city of Cleveland ordinances that are enforced and utilized in the municipal court, as well as the Ohio Revised Code, which is the Ohio State Legislature.
Right.
And then, of course, you know, we have Congress who enact federal laws.
Federal law. Yes.
Yes.
We have a caller on line one.
Or do we? Oh, maybe not. Maybe he's still, you know, screening the caller because he hasn't put anything up there yet. So, yeah, I'll probably give him a second.
We may even have to wait because we're headed. Richard?
Oh, yes. I had a comment, and I wanted to ask a question of the candidate. But the comment I wanted to make was on the creative sentencing you were talking about.
Yes.
That's done from time to time by a number of judges. Judge Deviney in East Cleveland, back about 30 years ago, used to do a lot of it.
Okay.
And I always thought it humiliated people unnecessarily. Mm-hmm. It was a publicity stunt. Got his name in the paper. Judges who do that, they get the publicity, but I always thought it was just a cheap way of getting publicity and wasn't necessarily focused on really rehabilitating the offender and preventing something bad from happening again. But the thing, question I wanted to ask about, I know that Prosecutor McGinty is talking about having all of the people who are arrested taken to one jail downtown, and the county would be involved early on, and it would make getting them before the grand jury more efficient. And isn't there a danger this will bypass the municipal courts and give the people the chance to first appear in municipal court and perhaps violate rights for the sake of simply speeding up justice? And I was just wondering what the thoughts of the candidate were on that.
That's, you know, both those comments are very, very interesting. I definitely, definitely take into serious consideration your first comment about humiliating people. And I That's mm-hmm. profoundly serious, and there is a balance. There's definitely a balance that must be struck. And if you are a judicial candidate or if you're a judge, you must be very mindful of whatever you do and the possibility of humiliating a person who's been hailed into your court. And I do take that seriously. And I may have been somewhat reticent earlier when I was asked about that. Because of that, I think you articulated better than I did. And you did. So thank you.
Okay.
Now,
and you hold that thought, I'm being hailed again. We have to go to a break. Richard, if you can hold on, we'll be back in just a moment with OCU Forum.
Okay.
If you have a senior parent that enjoys their freedom as much as you enjoy yours, you should know about the MedMinder. The MedMinder is a clever pill dispenser that reminds your mom or dad when it's time to take their meds and notifies you if they miss their meds so you can enjoy peace of mind. Here's how it works. You fill the MedMinder's compartments with a week's worth of pills, set the times that you want the pills to be taken, and that's it. The MedMinder does the rest. It notifies your parents with flashing lights, audio cues, and phone when it's time to take their meds, and will email, text, or call you if they miss their meds. And because it runs on cellular technology, no phone line or internet at home is needed. You can even check that they are maintaining their schedule on the web. There's a great video on their website that shows the MedMinder in action. You should check it out. The site is MedMinder.com, MedMinder.com. It's just $39.99 a month, but you can save $10 a month if you type in our station in the promo code WERE. Check it out now at MedMinder.com.
Right now at the Home Depot, you can save 10% on any appliance of $397 or more. Get the best new features and ideas from top brand names like Maytag, Samsung, and LG. From washers and dryers to ranges, fridges, and freezers, you can dream big without disturbing your wallet. Thanks to 10% off any new appliance of $397 or more. More saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot. Valid through May 1st, U.S. only. See store for details.
Have you asked yourself, can I really lose this weight? Do you stay away from large public workout facilities? Are you unsure of where you should start? Do you suffer from fibromyalgia, arthritis, hypertension, back pain? Let Majai Ultimate Fitness help you. Conveniently located in University Circle, Majai understands the physical and mental struggles of weight loss and physical limitations. Our one-on-one personal training plans are affordable and designed just for you. No general workout plan here. No one-size-fits-all, no boot camp. Majai is a completely holistic and homeopathic approach to gaining control of your life. We're located at 10916 Magnolia Drive in Cleveland, Ohio. Call us at 216-240-5669. We welcome men, women, and children. We are the Royal Bodyguards of Fitness because your royalty starts here. Majai Ultimate Fitness Studio, 216-240-5669. Call for your appointment today.
Welcome back. Welcome back to OCU Forum, your forum. You know, I always tell people, if we had a video camera, if we had a webcam in here, we would have our own show after the show.
We would, because we do. This is all the time. This is all the time. This is...
It's off the hook in here.
Yes, it is.
We have Richard on the line. Richard, are you still with us?
Oh, yes.
Okay. He was, the attorney was answering your question in reference to the comments you had made about how the prosecutor now wants to, and hopefully I'm saying it correctly, put everyone in one particular, was it a building?
Well, if I remember right, he said he wanted to take all of the people downtown to one jail that would be run by the county, and they could be routed to the grand jury much faster. And I was asking, isn't that simply a way, or wouldn't that have the effect of avoiding the municipal courts and not giving people the opportunity to make a plea in municipal court before the case is referred to the grand jury, or for a judge to see if it should be referred to the grand jury?
I think for sure the practical effect would definitely reduce the actual interaction with the municipal courts and the municipal prosecutors who, I agree with you that probably would have some insight as to their police officers, their municipal police officers, more so than, not in all cases, but you would think that the municipal prosecutors would have a closer interaction with their police officers than the grand jury prosecutors in the county. You know, as you know, that the in Cuyahoga County, we've pretty much eliminated the preliminary hearing, which is a process in criminal procedure that allowed for a hearing on the probable cause of a felony charge on a municipal level. And that was something that, of course, you know, that defense attorneys such as myself, we enjoyed that opportunity to actually put the government on record as to the theory of their case. That no longer exists for the most part.
I didn't know that had been eliminated, but...
Well, and for all intents and purposes, it doesn't happen in the city of Cleveland, because felonies get indicted grand jury prior to preliminary hearings.
But I do know that there were many instances in which certain policemen would bring cases before a prosecutor, and he'd look at it, and he'd tell the police that they're always bringing him cases without enough evidence, and he couldn't file charges. And it was, I guess, part of the value to the municipal prosecutor was, as you said, he knew the police. He knew which ones were likely to have substantial charges and which ones might be exaggerating, and he would know where to look for the evidence when they presented stuff to him.
I agree, because, you know, I agree with you that it sounds, and I'll be honest with you, I haven't looked into it closely, that particular initiative, but it does sound to me, you know, that things would be rushed. You know, if you're holding someone, you can only hold someone so long in jail without charging them. So if you're going to have everyone coming down to one jail, then it sounds like they're going to have to rush to get them indicted to keep them moving. You know, you got to get people in and out. So I agree with you. That is a serious concern. That is a concern that right. may either I or some other person who's equally concerned can bring up with the Cuyahoga County criminal defense attorneys.
That's well,
it. Yes.
Okay. All right, then. I'd like your answer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, consider
you
me
calling,
in the
Richard.
Fall, then.
Well, let me ask you a question. You brought up another very interesting point, and one of the things we try to do is educate people here. You said they can't hold you for how long? Just give people, you know, because we had a lot of our.
They like 72 hours. That's what people say. You know, we say it's 24 hours, but you know, while you're arguing, time is passing. So.
But when they get in trouble and they need an attorney, you can give your number so they can call you. When should they call you?
216-523-1100.
523-1100.
523-1100.
So when they first get the call from,
yes,
they should give you a call.
At
a 523, and that number again.
Yes, sir.
523-1100.
Yes.
See, I'm trying to behave myself.
No, one thing we always have a problem with in our community is our young men and women getting in trouble. We see that with the Just Us Center downtown.
Yes.
And I do believe if someone was to give you a call, you would be there to help them at least through the process, even if you couldn't help them, refer them to someone who can.
Absolutely. But I you know, of course, I would be blind and a fool not to make the observation that you make about the Just Us Center.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's pathetic. It's sad. I mean, from a social, not from an attorney's point of view, but from just a social observer, it's a sad situation.
And that's why we need someone that looks like us, that sits behind the bench, that comes from the community, that knows the problems that we deal with. Because, and I'm not saying everybody's innocent down there, everybody's not guilty down there. It takes someone who sits behind a bench to know what really goes on in our community. I've seen it several times where I've went with people downtown where the prosecutor piled up so many charges, they throw it against the wall, hopefully one of them will stick.
Yes. Overcharging.
Overindicting. And we see that.
Right.
So we need some judges down there who will be able to look through all the mess and say, you know what, I understand what you're going through.
Right.
And then also hand down the appropriate sentence at the same time. Not over-sentence someone, but also to the point where they learn their lesson at the same time.
I'll add to that. You also want somebody who's had some life experiences.
And right. That's what I'm, yeah. Now, one thing I would change about municipal court. Now, this is one thing I would change about municipal court. When I go down there, the young men and the young ladies and the way they dress, I'm not sure if you
can. Okay, that's a whole other
thing.
Right,
if you can recognize.
You need Judge Adrian here for that.
Thank you.
He sends people out. Listen, you going to the fair today? You going to the amusement park?
The court etiquette.
Certainly you're not dressed for court. Right. Well, that's a social thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. Just sort of, I think it's throughout society. It's not just us.
Right.
I think that, you know, there's a lack of formality in society nowadays throughout, and that's reflected in the court. People don't dress business-like. Mm-hmm. Even business people pretty much now don't wear ties and suits. I mean, that's just the nature of the evolution.
Now, when you become the judge, they're going to have your Channel 20 with the court cases like they usually do?
I think I don't know how to decide that.
Okay.
I don't know how to decide this courtroom.
We're going
to
make sure they get you on Channel 20.
Yeah. You know.
Now, I'm going to forewarn you.
Yes.
If you become a municipal judge, you ain't right.
Okay.
I'm coming down there with my bullhorn.
I know you.
You don't want to come with a bullhorn.
I've seen the bullhorn before.
Make sure this is the second hour of the show. You know the bullhorn.
I'm coming down in my bullhorn. They better not tell me you ain't right. Got you up here.
Somebody's always going to be mad.
Right.
You know what? That's true. But if I see evidence of, and Darnell, you know how I am. Come on now. Seriously, now you know how I am. If I see evidence that you ain't right, I get on you. It's just in me. I'm sorry. It's just the way I am. Look at his face, Darnell. Keep your face like, I want to do a picture.
She's been drawing me in all this time, but I see her mood is changing. Okay.
Things around these mics. So trust me, we're walking some fine lines. But
she saw the way I looked at her when I first came in. She said,
like, what?
Don't let it fool you.
Don't let it fool
I
you.
Am the bad one.
I tell everybody
I'm the good one.
What do I say? Darnell, don't I say that all the time? Seriously?
I'm the good one.
I'm the bad one.
Okay.
I am.
I believe you.
I'm a handful.
Oh, I believe you. Not to convince me.
Well, you can always have a court observer in your courtroom, right? And she can come down and observe.
And
you
I do.
You.
I go to the courts and I observe what the judges are doing, don't I? I go.
Mm-hmm. We should have that.
That's how had Judge Bianca on because I already knew Judge Bianca's rep.
That actually is so true, what he said. We need court observers.
You know what? Every election cycle that comes where judges are on the ballot, people always say, I don't know who to vote for.
Mm-hmm.
Just like you said, you didn't know my opponent was a Republican.
Mm-hmm.
People just don't know.
Right.
You know, we've seen judges come and go.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to name any names. Mm-hmm. But just as I go out, I hear people who only interact with judges when judges are politicking. And they think that these judges are looking out for
And they're not. And I know they're not. Well,
we always just say there's three people who can take away your life. One being God, one being yourself, and the third being a judge. A judge can literally render some type of
ruling
that can really destroy, even if it be a fine, if it be jail time, if it be some type of sanction.
Darnell, I feel like you're really going like this. I feel like you're pulling my train again.
I'm just stating the obvious how a judge can really, you know.
I want to behave myself until our guest leaves.
Well, I can't help you at the second hour, brother. I'm trying to help you.
He's going to be fine. Right. When our guest leaves, he's going to be fine.
Well, we want to thank you for sitting behind our mics of our music.
It's been
our
a pleasure.
First hour is over. We're going to be heading to our second hour. Once again, give them your number again, just in case they want to give you a call.
Okay, I'm Anthony Jordan, and I'm running for Cleveland Municipal Court Judge on November 5th. And I'm still practicing attorney. If you have a problem, please give me a call. 523-1100. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the first hour of OCU Forum.
We'll be right back with Darnell Brewer.
And Miss Mariah. We'll see you shortly.
Because of your love.
tell them what it's gonna be, y'all.
Views, opinions, claims, or representations are those of the participants and are not those of 1490 WERE AM's owners or management. Broadcast or rebroadcast in any form of 1490 WERE programming is prohibited unless otherwise agreed to in writing.
News Talk from ERE, Cleveland Heights, streaming live on the new BlackPlanetRadio.com.